Last time, 3 weeks ago, when we gathered here, we heard a talk about artificial intelligence by Hart Lepson from Columbia. And he told us how his whole field has changed in the last few years, how everything which was done 5 years ago basically is not very useful anymore because there were such great new developments, new algorithms, deep learning, leading to applications like self-driving cars, which you will see soon. So we are in an enormously accelerating phase of artificial intelligence. Also, on the level of neuroscience, just in the last few years, several billion-dollar projects have been launched in Europe, in America. There are tens of thousands of neuroscientists working on figuring out the wiring diagram of the brain, the processes in the brain, the algorithms that are at work there, the interplay between between the electrical and chemical properties of the brain. So we really live in an enormously exciting time. And if you put that in context, 400 years ago, science got started as we know it now with Galileo and then Kepler and 100 years later, Newton. If you look at the last 400 years of science, it has mostly been science of the world, of physics, chemistry, biology, both the non-living and the living world. But in those 400 years, we have used our own cognitive apparatus, our own knowledge, our own experience to do experimental and theoretical science. In those 400 years, we have used our cognition to learn about the world. But now, especially in the last 5 years, we are now using our cognition to learn about cognition. And that's an enormous change. Of course, neuroscience has been business for the last 100 years or so, until since we figured out how neurons fire and we learned more and more. But the enormous acceleration of the last few years make it, I think, fair to say that after 4 centuries of knowledge of the world, we now get a century of knowledge of knowledge. And whether it will take a century to really get a similar understanding of our knowledge as we have of the world, or whether it takes more than a century, nobody knows. And what is exciting is that it's not only that we're going to know the wiring diagram of the brain. Much more exciting is the fact that we'll get a deeper knowledge of our own knowing. And by definition, we don't know what the knowledge will be. If you go to a neuroscience convention, nowadays they have 10,000 people. It's like more than a village. It's like a small town of that everybody is a neuroscientist. I've never been to one, but it must be pretty amazing. If you go to a neuroscience convention, then everybody gives a talk about another little part of the brain. It is fascinating to see the progress, the amount of money, the amount of time, the amount of energy and dedication going into that. But none of these talks by themselves will lead to a new way of looking at the brain, a new way of looking at cognition. That will have to arise spontaneously in a way that nobody knows yet. We are now like in the time of Galileo. When Galileo was doing the first simple experiments, dropping balls, letting them slide down a plane, nobody knew that Newton would invent calculus, integration, differentiation. Nobody knew yet that Descartes was going to map algebra into geometry, in analytic geometry. All these discoveries would come later. Experimentation would lead to better theories, leading to better definition of experiments, leading to even better theories, and then these breakthroughs would come out. Now, nobody knows what the breakthroughs will be in the next 10 years, 20, 30, 100 years. But what I would like to talk about today is my guess of the nature, the overall nature of the breakthroughs. And I want to be very conservative. I will look at the 400 years of the building up of knowledge of the world. And I will try to say something about the next 100 years of the building up of knowledge, taking my clue from the knowledge of the world. Now, natural science is called an empirical study of the world. Empirical means it is based on experiment. It is not just speculation, it's experiment and theory going hand in hand. The secret of science, the secret of the way that Galileo and later Descartes and other scientists set up natural science, was to focus on the object, on one third of the empirical approach of experience. The subject and the interactions were put behind the screen, so to speak, like an old-fashioned photographer being under under a cloth and making a photograph of an object. If different scientists in different way measure the same properties of the same object, then it was called objective. So the invention of science was the definition of the objective methodology. And we now take it for granted. We have evidence-driven physics, biology, all the natural sciences. We take it for granted that that is how it is done. It took about 100 years to formulate how to do objective science and how to study objects independently of who studies it with what method. Now, this was true for the first 300 years of science. But then in 1925, something very, very unexpected happened. At that time, quantum theory was discovered. And it was discovered that quantum mechanics tells us that on a very small scale, atoms and molecules and elementary particles have properties which are dependent on how you measure them. We realized that you cannot longer talk about objects having properties as such. It is not only that you cannot measure them accurately, you cannot measure the properties independently of the interaction in a fundamental way. Interestingly, it took about 50 years until the mid-70s that John Bell formulated mathematically and precisely. This is a whole other story. But the bottom line is that there are no hidden variables in quantum mechanics, meaning that if a particle would have a property before you measured it, it would be inconsistent with measurements. The properties of a particle are partly caused by the particle, partly by the way I measure it. So we can talk more about that later, and it could be a separate talk. But the first 300 years, we could study objects as objects independent of interaction and subject. The last 100 years, 91 years, we are studying objects in an entangled way. The objects and the interactions are entangled with each other. We have to study them together. And my guess, it is just a guess, but my guess is that when we really understand consciousness through neuroscience, through artificial intelligence, and maybe artificial consciousness, AI, when we really understand consciousness, we have to understand the subject pole, the subject part of experience. And given that object and interactions are already entangled in a way which we didn't expect, I think it would be very unlikely that objects are entangled with interactions and subjects are not. That sounds just counterintuitive. The most conservative extrapolation of the history of natural science is that once we understand what subjects really are, what the subject pole of experience really is, then I would think all three will be entangled. I'm not talking about quantum consciousness, which many people like to do, because quantum mechanics is mysterious and consciousness is mysterious, so maybe they hang together. I want to stay very far away from that. I am using quantum mechanics as a hint that objects and interactions are intrinsically related, and as a suggestion that subject and interaction, and actually all three, are intrinsically related. Now, if I have some time, not much time, I would like to give a hint of in what direction a future understanding of the subject qua subject is different from interaction and object, in which direction that can be found. And just very briefly, before I let Barnaby into the conversation, very briefly, in the history of European philosophy, during the 400 years that science got started, there were a number of very interesting philosophers, and let me just mention four: Descartes, Kant, William James, and Edmund Husserl. All four of them thought very deeply about the nature of the subject, and they have paved the way for the kind of conundrums that we are now facing in neuroscience and in AI. Very briefly, Descartes started talking about, well, what is consciousness and what is the role of me as the person who is conscious? Descartes was saying, well, there is me and there are objects. But in a dream, you have yourself and objects. And in the dream, everything you see is me. So maybe I can say, this is me. You can also say, everything is me if it would be a dream. How do we know it's not a dream? That was Descartes' move, starting to introduce the subject as this small part of the world or as everything. Now then, 150 years later, Kant came and he talked about what he called a transcendental subject. Nothing to do with transcendental meditation or transcendental something New Age-like. Interesting as that may be. This was a technical term which Kant introduced as transcending the natural science world of objects. The experience in which we meet all the objects, our field of experience is what makes room for the appearance of objects, for the experience of objects. So, just like space makes room for objects, time makes room for motion, so my cognition makes room for cognition of objects. So my cognition is not a thing. I have a body and I have a brain, but what makes room for cognition, according to Kant, is the field of cognition, is the transcendental subject, which is not part of the world.
So in the landscape, mm-hmm. the scientific landscape that's now expanding, where we're going to be seeing a lot more knowledge to knowledge, mm-hmm. knowledge about knowledge, do you think there's promise for these different modalities coming into play and informing mm-hmm. science just in a much
absolutely.
Broader way?
Yeah. Absolutely. At the moment, science specifically excludes things like values, like beauty, like responsibility. That is all a very important part of our life, but that is not yet topics for natural science. And the interesting thing is that we are using all of our cognition to study a small part of the world. And we have the choice to only look at a very small part of the world. But as soon as we use our science to talk about our cognition, then we cannot limit it anymore. As long as we use our cognition to look at very specific objects, our cognition is not limited, but we study the objects and we can filter the objects. But by the time we use our knowledge, our scientific attitude to study our cognition itself, we cannot switch off part of our cognition, then we suddenly have to do the whole thing. And that is where all the modalities come in, and that is where I expect that a much broader field of cognition, many more different ways of knowing will be brought to bear to the study of the subject. And that is exactly what we want to do at Weihouse. We want to be broader than a university. We want to do not only interdisciplinary studies, but extra disciplinary studies outside the walls of existing universities. That is why we are talking about Weihouse getting engaged in art, in design, in technology, in crafts. Basically, no limits to the field of cognition.
So you mentioned philosophers, and that's really refreshing. I'm just wondering if you might say a little bit more about philosophical approaches and how those can help to expand mm-hmm. the scientific enterprise, and maybe speculate a little mm-hmm. bit about what a richer science might look like with yeah. those sorts of approaches. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mentioned a few philosophers, and one of my favorite philosophers is William James, who, in comparison with all the European philosophers, he was very pragmatic. And his examples are very simple. Often the sort of simplicity that physicists like, a very simple picture. For example, William James would say, if I look at an object like a bottle of water, I can look at this object as a material object. There is plastic, there is water, there is matter, it has a weight. But I can also look at it as an experience. If you ask, where is my experience of the bottle of the water? Many people would point to the head and say, my experience is in my brain. But if somebody asks me, where is the bottle of water? I point here. And you can look at this as an experience. I can feel it and see it and touch it. And you can look at it as a material object. And there are no two bottles of water. This is a material object and this is an experience. The way William James described it more than 100 years ago is that he says, if you take two intersecting lines, you draw on the blackboard two lines, there is one intersection point. The one point lies on two lines, but there is only one point. But you can consider it part of this line, you can consider it part of that line. And this world here is given in our experience for each of us. And this world is also the objective world which we share. So each and everything that we experience in the world is like the intersection between cognition and world. And in that way, we can look at the properties. If I look at the property of this bottle, that I can drop it, and maybe it can break or it can something can happen to it, that is part of the material bottle. If I have a piece of wood, if I can put wood in fire, if I can burn a piece of wood, that is the material object that I can burn. I cannot burn an experience, but I can have an experience of burning a piece of wood. So at every step, you can separate how these two elements come together. But cognition and world are not separate. You cannot have cognition without a material body, and you cannot know anything about the world, by definition, without cognition. So this is something where somebody like William James gave the simplest possible picture of what Kant had started and which what Husserl, in his approach to philosophy called phenomenology, later would build up on.
So as you're talking, I'm thinking this sound, if you're talking about philosophers, you're mentioning Western philosophers. Mm-hmm. Are there contributions that you might note that might be informative from Eastern philosophers or from mm-hmm. other fields, even theologians or others? Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. As far as theologians goes, I would go to monks and mystics who do the actual experiments, not so much the theoretical people. But in Asia, in Hinduism, Sufism, Buddhism, Taoism, all the great traditions, people have acquired enormous database of knowledge about thoughts, feelings, intuition, different ways of using your mind, different ways of training your mind. As simple as trying to see how thoughts appear and disappear. Something which we normally don't have a training with in our society. Everything is object training, not subject training. So the database of all these cultures is extremely rich and extremely beautiful. And if you take time to go into those, it is absolutely wonderful to study about these different traditions. The problem is to make connection between Western science and both Western and non-Western meditative, contemplative traditions. The problem is, there is one science which is all connected. They all use mathematics, they all use an objective method. But all these traditions speak a completely different language. So what we need to do in this century is to get the traditions to talk with each other and to get them to talk with science. And this is why I think that something like phenomenology, which is the most empirical type of philosophy, will be a great stepping stone.
So you're thinking about more knowledge about knowledge. But what does that look like? Does that mean more awareness about knowledge as well, by extension, more understanding, more wisdom possibly? Because it seems that enterprise of science for the last few thousand years, or the last 400 years, because of modern science, has been largely concerned with knowledge as it relates to other knowledge. And so in this quest for knowledge of knowledge itself, how do you think that interacts with greater awareness of the world, greater and greater wisdom?
Mm-hmm. Hopefully, when we get more knowledge of knowledge, hopefully we will learn to also become more responsible. The reason that natural science could only study facts, trying to focus on facts without values, the reason for that was that they were starting with the low-hanging fruit, with the objects. And they were trying to specifically shield and filter out the interaction in a subject. But if knowledge as a whole is studying knowledge as a whole, we have to include values. We have to include beauty, responsibility, ethics. And when I talk about this with my colleagues, they very quickly say, oh, you cannot be objective about values. But then I remind them and I say, what does it mean to be objective? And they say, study objects. Well, I ask them, how do you know that you have an objective knowledge of objects? And then as soon as we talk for a little while, the empirical definition of objective knowledge is that which appears in the textbooks of physicists, biologists, chemists. What they write in the textbooks, the upshot from articles which are published based on experiments and theories, that is something which is intersubjectively agreed upon. If the world community of physicists agrees upon a certain body of physics, the mathematics, the experiments, that is not something which is being given by an emperor or a god or something from outside. It is the community of working physicists who intersubjectively agrees on the properties of objects. And I see absolutely no reason that scientists in this century and the next few centuries will very carefully, intersubjectively develop new methodology, probably new mathematics, new ways of measuring, new ways of interpreting, just like people did in the 17th century. And it may take longer. It may take longer because to develop a methodology of intersubjective agreements of subject-based knowledge, the knowledge of the subject, is probably going to be more difficult than knowledge of objects. But I can see a path, and you mentioned non-Western traditions. There is a lot of knowledge there which I think is already detailed enough that it can be used for helping us to build this new kind of extended science. And just very briefly, I am an astrophysicist. Astrophysics could not have started without astrology. It was 1,000 years of astrology measurements of the Babylonians, which built a database which the Greek took over. They say, hold your gods, but you would like to have the data. And they led to the Greek astrophysics, astronomy, which then gave rise to modern physics around 1600. That is one example. Another example is chemistry. Chemistry started with the database of alchemy. And when an alchemist wrote down a recipe for something, maybe something had to happen on the full moon and maybe you had to use a dog's tail, then the chemist say, well, hold the full moon and the dog's tail, but what you put together is really interesting. Let us try to do that too. So every type of knowledge has a cultural environment, and then there is something which transcends the culture, and that can become universal knowledge. So the great traditions from medieval Christian mysticism, from Buddhism, from Hinduism, from Taoism, all these traditions have a tremendous amount of detailed knowledge. You know, it's so funny. We use the word mystic. We say, oh, that is just mysticism, that's mystic. We use that as if it's something vague and unclear. But if you would go back to the Middle Ages, the people who were most precise were the mystics, who always write about the seven layers of this and the eight towers of that and the 12 rooms of such and such. They were the ones who really tried to be precise and to have knowledge which they could compare with each other. So I think it is just a matter of time, in a very careful and painstaking way, to compare all these traditions.
So one of the other areas that White House is interested in is how sort of the confluence of these different areas comes together. And we haven't talked about technology too much, but artificial intelligence seems to be accelerating in terms of its capabilities. We already have machines that can answer questions for us and complete some simple tasks for us. I'm just wondering, as knowledge becomes instantiated in systems guided by artificial intelligence, how do you see that playing out with respect to our overall awareness and our overall ability to grasp perhaps new concepts that are too complex for us to grasp without such tools?
I think artificial intelligence is absolutely essential to really get a knowledge of the subject. And again, many of the ideas I say seem rather radical. A new mathematics, a new way of thinking, a whole new way of doing science, it sounds very radical. But again, I want to remind you, I feel I am more conservative than most of my my colleagues. Most of my colleagues look at the current form of science and they try to see what is the next step. I like to look at the last 400 years of science and see the big patterns and extend those patterns in a conservative extrapolation. So if I look at the 17th century, that was the time that people figured out that the heart was working like a pump. How did they find it out? Well, we had invented the pump. Engineers had invented the pump, and then the medical people recognized the heart like, oh, that is what it's doing, that squishy, moving thing. It could be a pump. It's amazing for us now to imagine that 400 years ago, people did not know what blood was doing and that it was being moved around by the heart. It was just unknown. Invention of the pump led to the understanding of the heart. Similarly, invention of sauna, of beds having echolocation, the invention of radar and sonar led to understanding how beds move by making little sounds which bounce off. So in general, it has been inventing something, we often had to invent something before we can recognize it. So to really recognize what the brain is doing, we probably have to invent at least bits and pieces of it in order to recognize it.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, I want to open it up to the floor a bit.
Thank you. You mentioned Hinduism, but there, in particular, Advaita Vedanta and Transcendental Shaivism preceded European methodology by hundreds of years, if not thousands. Mm-hmm. So what were they doing to come to those conclusions that reality is made of consciousness?
From what I have seen from Advaita Vedanta and what I have learned is that the notion of non-duality, of going beyond concepts, going beyond the polarities between something and the opposite, is something which is one road towards the deep understanding of the subject. Because if the subject tries to make sense of objects, you have to point to them, you have to name them, and you say, you have a red shirt, you have a blue shirt, and blue is not red, red is not blue, but you have to make these distinctions in order to even talk, interact with objects. But what Advaita Vedanta is doing is to go one step further than what I am now trying to do. I am trying to introduce a subject in addition to the interaction and the object, and they are trying to go beyond the subject and the object to non-duality. Maybe that is a few hundred years from now, but that's also on my program.
It seems like there are three possible paths. One is sort of shared introspection about consciousness, which I guess is what has been done traditionally. And then you sort of touched on things like using AI as a way to model consciousness and do simulation studies and do experiments and see if you can make a model that works and is predictive. And then the third is the imaging, like the functional MRI, that can map objective reality to your subjective reality.
Yeah.
So I'm curious what balance you see of which of those paths, do they combine? Is there one that dominates? How do you see that working?
All of these and more, I think they all have to come together. AI, but also robotics, where AI is actually moving around and interacting, and AI interacting with AI. I see an enormous field of possibilities. The field of AI people working with neuroscientists directly, and also in hybrid ways. The field of Western philosophers talking with people from Eastern traditions and from ancient Christian traditions as well. Different people comparing notes. Like in Christianity, you have the Trinity. In Buddhism, you have the Dharmakaya, Sammogakaya, Nyingmanakaya. And it is so obvious from an experimental point of view that that corresponds to God the Father, the Holy Ghost, and the Son. And if you look at Chinese wisdom, if you look at Confucianism and Taoism and Buddhism, Buddhism is closer to God or emptiness or Dharmakaya, Taoism more to Sammogakaya, and Confucianism more to Nyingmanakaya. Once you know, once you're familiar with the traditions, it's quite easy to see. But very few people are really familiar with more than one of these traditions. It has been my, you can say, a hobby, next to being a scientist, for the last 45 years or so, that I have been very curious to go into a number of these traditions and to get enough of a feeling to be able to translate to other traditions. I'm not a real super expert in any of them, but like what I just said, these parallels I'm beginning to see now, and I see why other people cannot see it if they haven't spent a few years in each, at least few years very seriously in these traditions. And also, many of my colleagues, if they talk with Christians or Buddhists or whatever, they are very, very hesitant, like talking about God is like superstition. But if I talk with them, and if I say, what is the experimental part? What is the experience? When you talk with people who really talk about meditation or contemplation or prayer, prayer in the second person, meditation in the first person, the core of that is to investigate presence, the sense of presence, the sense of being here, of being. And this is part of what I wrote in my little abstract, so it's a good thing I hadn't talked about it yet, that one way to approach the subject is that you look at how we tend to objectify ourselves. If somebody asks me, who are you? I say, I am Pete. That is my name. And if they ask more, I can say I'm from Holland originally, I'm an astronomer, I am male, I have a certain age. All of these things are things I have. But if somebody asks me, okay, you have all these labels, but what are you? Well, what I am is not the objective labels which stick to me, but what I am is a subject who is hearing, seeing, talking, thinking. The eyepole, what Kant started to call a transcendental subject, that is what I am. And the best way to find what I am is to drop what I have. And my understanding of prayer and meditation is to go back to the I am, to the sense of presence. And I think the knowledge of the sense of presence in another 100 or a few hundred years will be unified and connected with natural science. And it can only be done if we overcome the current limitations of natural science, just like science has been growing for 400 years. Give science more time by its own light to grow further. I do think we make connections with the other traditions.
How do you define the consciousness? There are so many definitions of it, and we all talking about it, but how do you actually define it?
That is a wonderful question, and the more and more neuroscientists I hear talking about consciousness as being inherent in the whole world. And they talk about panpsychism, which is a very interesting idea that that every piece of matter has already a little bit of consciousness. The problem with that notion is that panpsychism is a form of pan-materialism. You use the space in which matter appears, and then you project consciousness in there as a sort of an ether which is also spread out over space. But my point is that consciousness or experience is intrinsic to cognition. It is the space in which cognition happens. And the space of matter and the space of cognition as concepts are very different. So the real space of consciousness is not here in this material world seen as a material world, and that is why it makes it so difficult to come to grips with it. Neuroscientists talk about which part of the brain corresponds to which conscious experience, which is very interesting and very real and important to get these correlations. But then to interpret it, you need a wider space. And just very briefly, when we went from classical mechanics to quantum mechanics, we had to go from what is called four-dimensional space-time to Hilbert space, a very different mathematical space. And to understand consciousness, I'm convinced that we have to go to completely different spaces to see how we use our cognition in the other spaces in order to understand this space here. So, I'm sorry I cannot give you the answer. We need a few more Newtons and Einsteins in the next 100 or a few hundred years, but I am convinced we go into the direction of consciousness. And I think when people are trying to come up with solutions for maybe consciousness is here, or maybe it is there, or maybe it is related to this algorithm, or maybe it is panpsychism, that is far too quick. It would be like in the days of Galileo to guess what quantum mechanics would be like. You just can't do it.
You mentioned that in meditation you drop what you have. You drop your name, your background. And so I guess in that point, what is the difference between you and the person who is next to you? I mean, I don't know if I explain myself, but if you drop everything, the point of meditation is like being part of a bigger thing or a common self or something.
All these things are related, and the challenge is for, again, the next 100 years or so, I'm not in a hurry, you can't force these things. Is to make sense all the things you mentioned, how they react, how they are related with each other. And to make the relations, you have to know the space of discourse, the space of concepts, and the methodology. The one thing that meditation and prayer and scientific investigation has in common is to suspend judgment. If you really want to do science, you start with a working hypothesis. You don't believe and you don't disbelieve. Most scientists are not very good at it. You have the pet theory, but the ideal scientist and a community of scientists fighting with each other, on average, manage to avoid belief and disbelief and just keep their prejudice on hold and just investigate where their experiments lead them. And ideally, somebody in Buddhism or Christianity or Islam, whatever, in any experimental aspect to religion or spirituality, also takes a humble position and saying, I have an idea of God, I have an idea of a higher self, I have an idea of a deeper mind, but it's an idea. Let me drop those ideas and let me pray or meditate or investigate using my mind as a laboratory to get deeper insight in what is really going on. And it is the arrogant power play people in religions. It's the dogmatic priests and mullahs and what have you in each religion who say, oh, we know what it is and we kill you if you don't agree with us. That is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about those people who are curious to find in their own mind what the structure of cognition is, as far as they can see within cognition itself.
I'm very interested to hear about what kind of discoveries have been recently made about consciousness.
I think the most important discoveries in the last 5 years, which will lead up to consciousness, are AI, especially deep learning, and are what we now find about the brain, like the GPS system in the brain, for which Nobel Prize was given very recently, how we have a map inside our brain, which allows us to move around in the world. Absolutely fascinating. Those things are necessary steps to make a bridge between the objective description of our cognitive apparatus, the third person point of view, and the first person point of view of how we feel. We know what it feels like to move around, and we're beginning to know what the moving around happens in the brain. And we have to develop both the subjective and the objective description more and more. My guess will be that in the next 5 or 10 years, the objective advances of AI and neuroscience will continue at a very rapid rate. And I hope that we can get the people who study the subjective part of consciousness, that we can get them together, that they also make progress to meet somewhere in the middle. And at the moment, there is billions of dollars of funding for the studying of the objective properties of the brain. There is not yet billions of dollars of funding for studying consciousness from a first person perspective within consciousness. Now, Weihaus does not need billions of dollars. We don't even need $100 million dollars. But a few tens of millions of dollars would be really nice to reach out to all the objective people doing their things too. And what we want to do in Weihaus is within one place, within one building, our dream is to get a building somewhere here in the area, within one building on the ground floor to have a consciousness bar, like a sports bar. People who want to have a drink and talk about consciousness with others, they can come to the Wei Cafe of the Weihaus. The higher floors will have research offices. So people will be doing theoretical computer science, theoretical parts of other natural science. We probably cannot do experiments. The neighbors probably will not like that, but that's a separate question. And to have also other offices in which people study the subjective part of consciousness. Unless all of that happens in one place, and ideally with coffee and beer and wine, depending on the time of the day probably, if you get all of that together, I think we will have a working chance to really bridge the objective and subjective parts of the study of consciousness.
As the technology advances rapidly, probably sometime soon we'll be able to find a being somewhere. At that time, I'm curious to know what's the scientific society develop, like think that how do we communicate with them, and do we recognize them by objectively or subjectively?
You're talking about alien intelligence?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well,
how do we communicate with them? Do we just send email or text message? How do we do that?
Well, the answer is we have no idea. We have no idea how artificial intelligence will develop. We don't know whether some part of the internet is slowly becoming... the internet probably is already producing emergent properties. Which of these emergent properties will become partly autonomous? Which of those we could possibly call conscious in some simple way, like the consciousness of a cell, or a simple, or an insect, or maybe something more. We really don't know. This is such an exciting time. When I was a student, there was the excitement of exploring the universe, and exploring what genes are made out of, and how they interact. But this is so much more exciting than when I was a student. We are exploring what cognition can be, our own cognition, and we are making new cognition. We have no idea what it will look like. I really feel I am sort of short-changed. I was born 50 years too early. I wish I would be born a bit later and really see all these really wonderful developments going on right now. So the answer is I don't know.
I'm just curious as to how consciousness is related to emotional intelligence.
To consciousness?
How consciousness is related to emotional intelligence?
Oh, it's absolutely part of it. The trick of getting science started is that science started in a very, very naive way. It only looked at objects and only in a logical, rational way, and everything else was being put on hold. It's quite amazing that science started in Europe. You had the great civilizations of the Egyptians, the Indians, the Chinese for thousands of years. Why did they not develop science? I think the answer is that only the Europeans were naive enough, like children, to think that they can drop balls and do simple experiments and then can step up to understand the whole world. And amazingly, they were amazingly successful, but it started because of a very naive, simple way, and then getting more and more in there. So the fact that in the last 20, 30 years, emotional intelligence is something people can now talk about, and beyond emotion and intuition, that's really wonderful, and it will grow out further and further. It is all part of consciousness.
Peter?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.